Good afternoon. Welcome to another lecture in our series. We are rethinking open society through shot and shell, whatever happens. And as I said in a community meeting this morning, one of the crucial goals of our university during a period in which a kind of interesting episode that will go down in the history of our university. One of the things we want to say when this is over is we kept going. We kept doing what universities do, which is to think and teach and learn, and students get depressed because that means they have to finish their papers, and PhD students have to prepare for their orals and all those difficult issues. But that's who we are. We're a serious place. And nothing stops us from doing the work of a university, and nothing will. I've said that before, I say it again. I do want to note with pleasure how good it is to have international representatives joining us once again. The ambassador from the Republic of Ireland, the ambassador of Canada, and the chargé d'affaires of the United States have come yet again to these gatherings. They've become members of the family in the last months. They're not late to the party. They were part of this before our particular issues began. They were here long before because they value what we do. And then when we began to have what the British love to call a little local difficulty, they sprang into action. So I do want to thank them again for a fidelity that has been tested and been enormously helpful to our community. Let me thank you all for coming. We're on the eve of an Easter weekend, so it's wonderful that you're here in good numbers. And now let's turn to the business of hand. The miraculous sense of timing which never deserts this university, we're talking about democracy defended and challenged, and we have a wonderful exponent, a really great political theorist. This is a series that has had cultural theorists, historians, political scientists, specialists in the sociology and politics of Eastern and Central Europe. But I think Tom Christiano would be the political theorist contribution to our discussion, a great theorist of democracy from the University of Arizona, where he directs a center in that area, a person whose work has had a great effect in defining the theoretical and political theory debate about democracy. And so it's a tremendous pleasure to have him here. He's also a friend of CEU going a ways back, because as you've been telling me, you've been here at a summer school.
Yep.
And so he is no stranger to Budapest and no stranger to this wonderful institution. So I will give Tom Christiano a very warm welcome. Let me just say that we will go until, he's got until 6:30, he knows his marching orders, and then we're going to have a half an hour questions, and the evening will end promptly at 7 o'clock. Thank you very much. Tom.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you so much for inviting me. It's really an honor to be speaking here today at this wonderful university, Central European University. It's a special honor to be invited by Michael Ignatieff, many of whose books I've read and taught in my classes. And it's great to see old friends here and be in this absolutely beautiful city. I want to talk to you today about some thoughts that I've had, and I think they're especially relevant to the contemporary political situation. They're partly in response to a recent spate of books on democratic theory that have been extremely skeptical, and they're partly a response to that. But then I'm going to try to make some further advances in the discussion, sort of beyond these critiques. So let's see here. See if I know how to work this. There we go. So today I want to talk about a basic puzzle that I have about the way democracy is supposed to work, if it works at all. It's a very basic puzzle. We're going to explore some different dimensions of this puzzle, and we're going to explore some partial answers to it. But I end up also with only partial answers, and in some cases just pretty open questions. Basically what I want to do is characterize this basic puzzle about how it works, and particularly in the relationship between democracy and information. I'm going to discuss some recent critics, as I mentioned. There have been a spate of like four or five books which are very skeptical about democracy. And then I'm going to critique that criticism. All of that is going to be to serve as a background to discuss what I'm describing as, in some sense, the micro theory of democracy, which I'll characterize more generally later. But basically, the micro theory is trying to think about what the individual citizen is doing and how they can participate and how to make sense of citizen participation. That problem is going to become particularly alive once we go through this basic puzzle and the contemporary criticisms of democracy. I'm going to briefly go through a discussion of economics, some economics of information. It's just going to be a few rough principles that I'm going to be describing, and how these connect with democratic institutions. Okay, and I will close by discussing a number of particular issues that arise for democracies. In one case, a kind of an institutional issue. In another case, an issue about what kinds of decisions this democracy has to make. So let's start with the basic puzzle. The first thing to note, and which is often not noted about democracy, is that democratic societies are characterized by a quite complex division of labor. Okay, it's a complex division of labor in the sense not only that different people do different jobs, it's a cognitive division of labor as well, such that the formation of policy in a democratic society is itself requires a lot of different people who specialize in a lot of different areas. So you'll have scientists, and you'll have politicians, and you'll have diplomats, and you'll have a lot of different people who have to specialize, and they specialize in the knowledge that they have, which means, of course, that a lot of other people don't have that knowledge. Okay, and so the division of labor is a division of cognitive labor. The consequence of having such a division of labor, which is particularly makes for a difficulty in the case of democracy, is that each person in that division of labor has only a limited understanding of the other parts of the division of labor. They have only a limited understanding, at best, of the science, of the complicated mechanics of legislation, and so on. The puzzle, of course, is established because you have this division of labor. But what's supposed to characterize democracy is that citizens are supposed to be, as it were, the ruling element in democracy. And that is, there, in some sense, the ordinary citizens are supposed to be driving the whole system. Okay, but of course, the ordinary citizens, most of them have their own jobs, which are not connected with politics, have their families, have very complex lives. Which in some sense make it very difficult for them to know a lot about what's going on in the political system and how it's working. Okay, So the puzzle is going to have to do with this division of labor. You'll recognize from my description of this first part, Plato's discussion in the Republic, where Plato thinks that these facts show that democracy is worthless. Okay. The puzzle, however, is established by the second thing to notice, which is that democracies, certainly of reasonably high quality, have tended to be the most successful societies that we've seen. Okay, I mean, there are lots of different dimensions of this kind of success. One is they don't go to war with each other. It's one of the best established phenomena in international relations theory that there is, the democratic peace argument. There are a few people who disagree, but not many. There are a lot of other facts which are quite striking about democracy. One, they're a lot better than other societies in terms of the production of public goods, you know, reduction of pollution, and so on, protection of the environment. In terms, they're massively better in terms of the protection of human rights, and certainly of basic human rights, in terms of the provision of basic needs, the protections of property and the rights of workers. They have also had, certainly universal suffrage democracies have had quite high per capita growth rates and have protected people from the most serious economic crises. I mean, the economic crisis we had in 2008 was terrible in many ways, but was nothing compared to what was going on in the early 20th century and the late 19th century. And democracies have been doing this, despite the fact that the people who seem to be ruling it aren't very well informed. Okay, and we can see the list here is supposed to suggest a broad-based set of advances to human interests. It's not just elites who are being protected. It's everyone, although some more than others, without a doubt. So that's the basic puzzle. You've got this characterization of democracy that, for example, Plato thought, you know, would lead to disaster. But then you have this other rather recalcitrant fact, which is that democracies are quite successful societies. So the question is, how to explain this? It's hard to fit these two elements together. It's hard to see how a society that seems to be run by people who don't know that much would not be run into the ground. Okay, and Plato, you know, thought, you know, if you try to steer a ship down a certain channel, and the people who were running the ship didn't know how to pilot a ship, well, it would run aground. That's what would happen. Why doesn't this happen in the case of democracy? This is a puzzle which I think not enough people have been focused on, and which needs to be given a serious and careful analysis. So what I'm going to start, however, with is with a group of critics who have, in some sense, taken one side of the puzzle and then sort of driven it all the way and become extremely skeptical about democracy. Okay, I mean, some writers, recent writers on democracy, just argue that it has to be a failure. The basis of the claim is, as we'll see, a certain, what I call, micro-theory of how democracy works that's partially supported by evidence. So I'm going to describe this view to you a little bit and the nature of the arguments, and then the problem with it as I see it. Now, there are two elements to this view. One is what we might broadly call a rational choice account of citizenship, which I'll characterize. And the other one is based on a certain amount of survey data and empirical analyses. Okay, so the first feature is about democracy to take note of. And this, I'm going to characterize the critics' view on this, and not, because I'm going to modify this as we go on in the discussion. The critics' view is citizens economize on information gathering. How do they do that? Well, your basic economics idea is going to be what they're going to do is they're going to collect information, and we do this in everyday life, at least the economist wants to say, to the point where the marginal benefit of that information is equal to the marginal cost of collecting it. Okay, so you stop doing it at the point where there's equality of marginal benefit and marginal cost. Okay, the second premise is key here. The value of information in helping achieve good political outcomes, these critics say, is nearly zero, okay, because of the extremely low probability that one's vote makes a difference, right? I mean, if you're voting in a country with where you have 20 million voters, your vote has a very, very small chance of making a key difference, okay? And that's an ineradicable fact about the nature of voting and participation. So then the thought is going to be, citizens will not, if they economize on information collection in the way that is normally described, as we'll see with a certain qualification, then they're not going to be informed at all, or only a very small amount will they be informed by. And there are those people who are informed, who have some knowledge of the political system and of the issues that are in play, are going to use those issues irresponsibly, are going to use their knowledge irresponsibly. Again, because the thought is going to be, your participation doesn't make a key difference. And so as a consequence, the costs of your making a bad decision or a good decision are very small. Okay, or a bad decision in particular. That's the way the critique works. The source of this critique comes from Anthony Downs's famous work, An Economic Theory of Democracy. I recommend it to everybody who hasn't read it. It's one of the best books that's ever been written on democracy. As we'll see, Downs has a much more interesting set of views about democracy than just these simple ideas. But this basic idea comes out of Downs's theory. Now, the basic picture here, and I'm offering an image and sort of a memorable image from a recent book called Against Democracy by Jason Brennan, is that citizens are generally going to be divided into what he calls hobbits and hooligans. Okay, the hobbits don't know anything, okay? The hooligans are ones who, because of intense partisanship and a kind of tribal, solidarity with their particular ideological group, simply advance their views very intensely and have contempt for all of their opponents under all circumstances. The first group, the hobbits, are rationally ignorant. The second group are rationally irrational. This is another skeptic of this view, Brian Kaplan, who developed this term rational irrationality in this context. So the thought is democracies, according to this skeptical account, are essentially composed of hobbits and hooligans. And so the problem, of course, is that it's really hard to see how a society is going to be well run under those circumstances. Okay. Now, question is, okay, what's the evidence for these kinds of claims? Okay, and there are two basic bodies of evidence that people draw on. The most important body of evidence that people have drawn on are these national election surveys that have been going on since the 1950s, certainly in the United States, but they've also happened in European countries. I think there's one for France, has been conducted occasionally, and some other countries. National election surveys, which basically ask people basic questions about politics, okay? About issues as well as about the structure of government, like, which party controls Congress, who's the president, things like that. What they find with these surveys is that, in fact, a very small proportion of people really know the right answers to these questions. Oftentimes, a dispiritingly low number, like one third or one quarter, will get the right answer to something like, who's the president, or who is, what's the party in Congress in the United States. So That's one. So there is a fair amount of ignorance that's suggested in these surveys. Okay, so that's the first thing to note. The second thing to note are studies of group deliberation, where you have groups that are supposed to deliberate over some issue, and then people have studied these processes of group deliberation to see how they go. And what they have found is pretty mixed results about the quality of deliberation, the extent to which people learn from each other, the extent to which they get things out of these processes of group discussion. And one process that a lot of people have talked about is this process of group polarization, which is sometimes when you've got two groups of somewhat different sort deliberating together, they tend to polarize and go into extreme opposites in their opinion. So they don't learn from each other, they actually do the reverse of that. At least that's what the critics are talking about. And I think the critics overplay this kind of information. In fact, the general studies of group deliberation are pretty mixed, and most people say, well, they're good sometimes and not so good, and there are complicated questions about when they work and when they don't work. But nevertheless, this is the kind of evidence that these skeptics want to look at. Now, what they do is they make an inference, okay, from the micro theory. And here you see what I mean by micro theory. In other words, it's the theory of how each person gets information, how they make a decision, and how they decide how to participate and what they do, okay. The idea is from the micro theory and the evidence, it's inferred that democracies can't be successful. And from this, the skeptics diverge, and there are two different ways in which they go. One argue for much smaller government. This is a person by the name of Ilya Soman, where much more decision-making goes to the market. Okay. And a second group, I think they're sympathetic with the first inference. The second group is they advocate something like rule by experts, or what Jason Brennan calls epistocracy. But basically what he means is a kind of rule by experts or rule by the educated and so on. Brian Kaplan also thinks that it should be rule by experts, and he has in mind economists and so on. So that now most of these thinkers are generally skeptical of democracy and generally very pro-market and think that mostly the market should replace democracy in decision-making. But some of them, again, just say, well, we want smaller government. Others rule by experts, usually economic experts of their favorite sort. Now, you can recognize, of course, the rule by experts here. That, of course, owes its origin to Plato again. That's his main conclusion, in some sense, from this whole argument. So that's the basic argument that these skeptics make. Now, the trouble is, I think that the argument, because the way when I gave you the basic puzzle to start with, I think the problem is that the argument actually is deeply problematic because the conclusion is false. Okay. So if you got an argument, that P implies Q, and then you got P, therefore Q, but it turns out the Q is false, okay, then the first premise is going to be false, or the second premise, or both, okay. So the problem is again that the conclusion isn't defensible. In fact, democracies are of reasonably high quality have been quite successful. Now, of course, a lot of the people making this argument, as I mentioned to you before, are people who believe in, that the market should, in some sense, regulate most of social, or all of social life, or almost all of social life. And so they think of the rise of the welfare state, in some sense, as a catastrophe of some sort. And so they, perhaps that's what they think is the sense in which it's not successful. We can talk about that. I don't think that's true at all, even from an economic standpoint. But the second problem with the argument, of course, is that it's not really going to make for a good argument for the markets, because, of course, markets have the same problems as democratic institutions, as we'll see. That is, there's a tremendous deficit of information among most people who make even vital economic decisions for their own lives. Okay, it's a very important feature of how markets work. So it's hard to say that one is better than the other because of the information deficits. There may be another argument, which I'm not going to go into here because I don't want to focus primarily on the skeptics. The third is that, contrary to what some of these thinkers say, we have actually had some experience of societies that have been ruled by experts. First of all, I mean, the Soviet Union and the satellite states were claimed to be ruled by experts. I mean, the Communist Party was supposed to, as it were, have superior knowledge of the interests of workers to the knowledge that the workers themselves had. Other societies, which are in some sense not ruled by experts so much, but ruled by the educated, like 19th century France or Britain with very limited franchises, okay, we've seen to some degree how they worked during the 19th century. And in general, I think contemporary democracies, certainly post-war democracies, have succeeded much, much better than those particular societies on all the various dimensions that I just described. So the inference is problematic in a fairly straightforward way, but it leaves the question, and which is the basic puzzle again, which is, well, how does this work? How do we get something that's okay, at least okay, and really, fairly well working, while at the same time we have people who cannot answer these questionnaires very well, and so on. How does this work? Okay, and in order to answer this question, what we have to do is we have to go back to the micro theory and ask, what's going on there. And just something that I've mentioned already, which is, vital market decisions are made by people who are mostly ignorant of many of the basic properties of the things that they use. I mean, I take myself as the best example in the world of being ignorant of almost everything, except for the things that are in my books or something. But, I mean, what's in my toothpaste? What's in my car? What's in my body, actually? What are in my financial arrangements? I don't think I could answer those questions. I mean, I might if I spent some time going over them, but I can't answer them very well. The reason why I bring up this fact is because I think it's generally accepted that at least in a significant areas of life, and particularly with some of these areas, markets work at least reasonably well, despite the lack of knowledge that people have in those markets. And the reason for that is that the lack of knowledge in markets and in democracy, I don't think entail that choices are not made on the basis of good information. Now that's going to sound paradoxical, but I want to try to explain that in a minute. But the basic idea here is that people use information shortcuts in everyday life and in politics. When I want to figure out why I'm sick, I don't go get a medical degree, which would take me 5 or 6 years. I go to the doctor, and it takes me a half an hour, and then I get an answer. And I won't be able to tell you why I get that answer, but he's going to give me the answer, or she's going to give me the answer, and then give the prescription for how to get better, and usually it works. I don't have to have done these things. Now, there's another problem with the micro theory, and that is that of the critics that I just described, which is the extent to which people are ignorant on this model also has to depend on the extent to which they care about the common good. Okay, why is that? Because if you think take the case of a person who's purely self-interested. Okay, if you vote, okay, in an election where there are 20 million other people or 100 million other people, the chance of you getting the result you want is going to be one out of tens of millions. Okay, that is of your making the difference. I mean, of course, the chance you get what you want is going to be one out of two in terms of the actual outcome, but you didn't make the difference to it. Okay, if you had not voted, it probably would, the outcome would have been more or less the same. Chances are very low. Now, if you're purely self-interested, then you're going to think, it's not worth my while. Okay, even if one candidate's a lot better than the other, it's not going to be worth your while to vote. Okay, but of course, if you're not purely interested, self-interested, and you assign weights to a lot of these other people's interests, let's say some weight to the 20 million other people's interests, then even if the value of the vote is heavily discounted by this low probability, the outcome, the value of the outcome is massively increased so that it might actually make it worth your while. Okay. Now, I say that, I'm saying that not because I know the answer to the question of how motivated people are. My guess is there's not a single answer for people generally. Some people are very much concerned with the common good, probably most people to some degree, at least when they vote. Some people probably aren't. You know, how much sacrifice they want to put for this depends. And of course, you know, the economics of information are going to depend on how much they think that that's valuable. Now, so another big problem with the micro theory that we described, that I described earlier, is that it turns out that in all these societies where they do these studies, affluent people, you know, upper middle class and wealthy people, tend to be fairly well informed. And the rest of the population tends to be less well informed. Okay? Fairly well informed, less well informed. But the theory can't explain that difference. Okay? It doesn't, because they all, each one of them has the same probability of having an effect through the voting. So they tend to be, some people tend to be quite well informed, others don't. And it's not explained by the theory. Now, why would some people be better educated? Now, one basic reason is, of course, affluent people tend to be, in most of the societies under study, better educated. They've had a better education. In the United States, it's very easy to see that. They either go to private schools or they go to public schools in wealthy areas. And so they get better education. The second is that the affluent have lower opportunity costs in collecting information, because the value of a dollar in collecting information is not as high for them as for a poor person. The third is that the affluent have better sources of what Downs calls free information. The whole Downsian theory is oriented around this idea of what he calls the free information system, which is absolutely essential for any kind of understanding of the economics of information here. That is, free information is information in this context. Free information about politics is information that I acquired not because I was interested in politics, but for some other reason, namely because of my job, because say I'm a lawyer or something like that, I might know something about the law. That's part of my job. But that might also be informative to me about politics. So relative to the political question, it's free information. Okay. Obviously, government officials are going to have free information of this sort. But generally, affluent people will tend to have more of this kind of free information than other people, because the kinds of jobs they work on are jobs which interact more with law and government and so on. Now, what I think we need to do here is sort of think in terms of a better, as I put it, micro theory, okay? So let's just talk briefly about the economics of information. So people collect information up to the point where the benefit of an extra increment is equal to the cost of that increment, okay? Now, you might wonder, well, how do you figure that out? I mean, especially if you don't have any information in the first place, then it looks like you're in bad shape, right? But even if you do have some information, it may be difficult. And so there are different theories about how people proceed in this kind of context. I'm not going to go over them in any detail, but maybe we can do it in discussion if you want. But how do they determine this? Well, this is the key role of where free information comes into the picture, okay? So information that they acquire for other reasons. So let me say just the elements here of this kind of basic economics of information. You've got preferences. This has a problematic role in this story, but I'm going to leave it as it is at this point, just in terms of preferences. You've got free information that, as it were, give you some sense of what the issues are for how to satisfy these preferences. You've got information shortcuts, namely ways to economize on your information collection so that you can satisfy these preferences in ways that are not too costly. You've got networks between people. This is going to be a very important part of the picture here. And then the final conclusion here is going to be that institutions matter. Okay, so let's say about free information. So the most basic source of free information is just information you get from other people. You have to go to school, and so you get it from your education. You get it from work. Again, a lawyer or a business person will get a lot of information from work. You get it from your colleagues who are, they got it from work to some degree, and you talk to each other and you have a discussion and you learn things about what you need to know. And of course, friends and family. The thought is going to be the most basic starting point for the information collection process is in these relationships among persons. There are other sort of more incidental sources of free information. For example, you watch television or something like that, and a news flash comes on, and you learn something. Even if you didn't seek it out, you still learn something. Now, as I mentioned before, the thought is going to be something like affluent people tend to acquire knowledge in government and of government and policy through their jobs. It's obviously true of government officials. It's, I think, true to a great extent of others as well. They have to know about these things in order to do their jobs. And, of course, they're networking with other people who have to know about this in order to do their jobs as well. And so, as a consequence, they're going to have a lot of free information, first from their own job and then from people who have similar jobs and so on. Okay. Again, there's going to be a big difference between these affluent people and persons, say, for example, who work in factories or in a restaurant or other kinds of jobs like this. The thought is going to be, in those contexts, it's not part of your job to know about policy and government. And so as a consequence, you don't get that as free information. You're still going to be talking to people and so on, but it's not going to be as strong. And so that explains, I think, in significant part, the difference in information between affluent people and the non-affluent. Now, shortcuts. An information shortcut, is a way in which I get information or I use information without, as it were, getting all of the information, okay? So, for example, I might learn something about what the government is doing by reading an opinion leader's set of opinions. Okay. In that case, the thought's going to be something like, this person has done a huge amount of research and sort of boiled it all down to this fairly simply manageable set of ideas, which then I get. That's a shortcut for me to become informed by somebody else. Okay. An information shortcut is a good one, okay, to the extent that it helps me satisfy those preferences that I have without, as it were, undergoing all the costs of getting information. That's the key criterion, in some sense, for when it's good. So look, I mean, just a simple case. When I'm sick, I go to the doctor. Okay, that's an information shortcut to find out why I'm sick. I could go to medical school for 6 years. Well, I'd have to go first to science, study science as an undergraduate, and then I'd have to go to medical school and do it that way as well, right? Or, if my car's not working, I go to a mechanic. I could spend a long time trying to figure out how cars of this sort work and then not use the mechanic, okay? But the trouble is, and here you can see now the connection with the division of labor, okay, if I didn't use these shortcuts, and if you didn't use these shortcuts, at least most of the time, you wouldn't have enough time for your regular job, okay, and your family and other things that you have to do in life, okay? You just wouldn't have it. It would take up all your time. Now, it's a feature of the division of labor. As a consequence, I think societies would ground to a halt if, as it were, people didn't use these information shortcuts. So it's an essential feature of modern societies. Now, here's another example. If I want to buy a car, okay, I don't know anything about cars. And I don't really like cars very much either. But, you know, sometimes I have to get one, especially I live in Tucson, Arizona. It's you have to drive almost everywhere. I look maybe to a set of consumer reports, or maybe my wife will look at consumer reports, do a quick comparison of things, okay. There, we've used a shortcut, okay, and which has, you know, made the information very digestible, all right. One of us probably hasn't used it. Either I've looked at it and told my wife, or my wife looked at it and told me. So the consequence is going to be, if I looked at it and told my wife, she wouldn't know anything about this car. She'd just say, yeah, it's a good car. I know it is because my husband, who read the consumer report, said so, and I believe him. As a consequence, if you think in terms of survey questions, if somebody asked a question about what some properties of this car, neither of us probably would know the answer after a couple of weeks, because after I've got that kind of information and then I use it, then I forget it once I've used it. Okay, so that information fades very quickly, but some people don't have it at all because they just rely on other people. Okay, now. So what you can have, I think, is what's sometimes called rational ignorance. In other words, not knowing about these things, okay, but still good choices. And that's really the interesting phenomenon here. Once again, if somebody asked me about my car, I wouldn't be able to give them a good answer. But my choices are based on good information, nevertheless, as long as the shortcut that I use, in other words, the people that I consulted, are good sources, okay? That's the key feature. And we see this, again, in economic life and in political life. Now, I say as long as, because that is still a question here. Sometimes the shortcuts turn out to go bad, okay? And then in societies like ours, what goes on is there's some kind of alarm bell. Somebody who knows something about this points out the mistake. It gets widely disseminated, and then the shortcut starts to fade. People don't use it, they use others. Okay. there are two different types of shortcuts here. The sort of positive one, which is I get information from somebody that something is a good thing, and then another sort of shortcut which tells me, oh, this source is a bad one or is problematic. Okay. The point here is, when I buy the car without knowing much about it, I still made a good choice, which has thankfully generally been true. Still made a good choice because the shortcuts have been good ones. Okay. And the choice, in some sense, is based on good information, although it's not information that I retain. All right. What's going on here is that we're all depending, as it were, on networks of people, with experts, networks of friends, colleagues, and so on, as shortcuts to economize on information gathering. That's the essential fact of modern life, both in economic life as well as, I think, political life. Okay. Now, again, I'm mentioning the affluent here because this is going to come up later on in my discussion. Again, the affluent, in some sense, have some edge here because they tend to have better free information, and then they have better tools with which to evaluate the shortcuts. Okay. Now, notice what's happening here. If you think that good choices are based on good information, but the good information is in some sense dependent on the networks that you have with other people, okay, which help you to economize on information, a lot is going to depend on the quality of the institutions in that society. Okay, a lot is going to depend on them. So if you have a society with a lot of corruption, at least in some certain area, the quality of information declines, and people become much more self-dependent. Now, that may sound like a good idea, but actually it's a terrible idea, because what they do is they end up wasting time getting information that they could have saved on had the society been less corrupt. There's a huge amount of study about the nature of an economy where there is a low level of usable information, and where there aren't reliable shortcuts. They're deeply inefficient, okay? The best example, of course, is the subject of a famous paper by an economist, George Akerlof, called The Market for Lemons. It's a suboptimal market in used cars because people can't get the kind of information or information shortcuts that they need. But the key thing here is to remember how reliant this process is on the institutional background in the society. Okay. Now, politics. Okay, so we can just go through the same kind of phenomena here. If we think about political life, people rely on free information from education, work, family, and friends to start, getting some sense of where they're going to go, what to read, what newspaper to read. I mean, read the newspaper your parents read or something like that, right? That's a kind of information shortcut that you've taken to figure out where to get more information. Then they rely on shortcuts, okay, with the help of media and interest groups and political parties and opinion leaders, okay? So, I mean, one thing that characterizes modern societies is the massive amount of investment in this process of dissemination of information about politics and of argument that's going on all the time in newspapers, magazines, television. It's constantly going on. Which already suggests, the critical view that we talked about earlier seems not to make sense of that, because obviously there's this huge amount of information that people are spreading around. But even there, the thought is going to be there's generally shortcuts. In other words, what's happened is you rely on a report from somebody that makes a very simple claim about what's happened, okay, and then you take that to be sufficient knowledge of what's actually happened, okay? Or political parties. A political party, you know, I mean, in the United States, if the Democratic Party, I mean, here, I'll reveal my political, if the Democratic Party prefers a policy A to policy B, or prefers a candidate A to candidate B, for me, I don't really need to know much more, really. Because if you're making a comparative judgment, then that's all you need to know. Okay? Because it's a good shortcut, and the reason why is because in general I agree with the ideology, or somewhat of the ideology, certainly more with the Democrats than the Republicans, and I see that they have expertise and so on, and so I go along with it. It's a massive shortcut. I mean, suddenly very complex decisions can be limited to a very small amount of information. Opinion leaders are another source. Now, of course, it's essential to a democratic society that there be a diversity of these groups, diversity of political parties, diversity of interest groups, diversity of all these different things, because one, as I mentioned earlier, one essential shortcut in the whole system is a kind of system of alarm bells. So, you know, if suddenly the analysis of some particular opinion leader proves to be, you know, particularly weak, and you see lots of people, observing this, then you say, okay, well, maybe I'm going to move away from that and go towards somebody else. It's essential that you have diversity here so that you have people who are looking at what other people are saying and that they have some kind of expertise here. Now, the thing is that all of this, again, in order to work well, relies on good institutions, okay? So in other words, the networks that you learn, get these information shortcuts from, have to be reasonably trustworthy. And this is a big, big issue, and this is a big issue in the evaluation of these institutions, okay? All right. Now, one thing I don't want to, I've said this earlier, but I want to repeat here. I'm not suggesting that people vote their interests. I think that we can trust surveys that people are concerned with the common good to some degree when they're involved in politics. Okay. But it is important that even if people do have a conception of the common good and people think in those terms, I think one fundamental feature of democratic life and one fundamental element of the justification of democracy is that we think that people are pretty biased in their understandings of these things. They're biased to some degree towards their own interests, and they're biased to some degree towards their own experiences, and so on. So even if people are concerned with the common good, it's going to be the case that if you leave a particular group out, okay, their interests are not going to be well served. Which we've seen. I mean, I think to some degree we see that in 19th century France and Britain, in those democracies. Those societies which have very limited franchises. Now, a quick word about intrinsic and symbolic values of democracy. I spent much of my career trying to argue how democracy might have intrinsic value. And nothing that I'm saying here is going to be in opposition to that, because in fact, the idea that democracy enables people to advance their interests and gives them a certain power to advance their interests is an essential part of the argument for the intrinsic value of democracy, because what democracy is supposed to do is give them, to some extent, equally instrumentally valuable power. And democracy has symbolic value to the extent that people are able to have their interests advanced democratically. so that when they're deprived of power, the people who are depriving them are thereby showing their lack of interest or concern for the interests of those people. Okay, so this is just, I just wanted to make a note of this, but the I think all discussions of democracy are going to rely on this kind of phenomena, on this kind of the importance of being able to advance interests in this context. Okay. Now, so I think what we see in the case of democracy is you see a political system that's structured in such a way that everybody's interests are advanced to some degree, okay? Certainly not equally by any means, and because we see that they don't have equal power by any means. It doesn't really live up to the ideal of democracy. But we do see that the interests are advanced, and I think we can see how that's possible given ignorance by means of the understanding information shortcuts that people can use all the time, you know, namely, you know, what their political party thinks or what their what an opinion leader thinks, and so on. They can get enough to understand what's going on, at least to some degree, and advance their interests. Nevertheless, there are two, I think, major challenges for democracy, and I'm going to go through these pretty quickly because I want to get finished quickly. First. There's a challenge of non-affluent participation. How can it be enhanced through more highly informed citizens? And second, there's the challenge of how states and how democratic decision-making can be made relative to international politics. Okay. In the case of working-class politics, I described to you a little bit how politics, how the non-affluent and the affluent have different sources of information. So I'm just going to give you a quick hypothesis here that to some degree this difference between affluent and non-affluent information can be mitigated to some degree by the presence of unions, okay? Because unions do mix economic life and political life in such a way that people, ordinary workers, have, as it were, get some understanding of politics on, say, the shop floor, so to speak. And it's because of the peculiar role of institutions in economic life and political life that they're able to do this. So let me go on to the next challenge here. International politics. States have become much more interdependent. Through trade, through through public bads, public goods, environmental law, and so on. But the one major challenge in American and in most democracies is that the capacity of people to have an understanding of international politics, of trade, of the various ways in which we're interdependent with other countries is very low. That democratic discussion of these things is at a very low level, generally. In the United States, we just had an election where somebody argued against free trade on the ground, in favor of protectionism. And the contrary argument, at least popularly, just wasn't made. It's like, there just isn't a discussion of these matters. It's quite striking. But without a discussion of the benefits and costs of free trade, you can't discuss, how to mitigate the costs of free trade, which is, of course, one of the reasons why a protectionist seems to have won the election. So that's another challenge, I think, that's very hard to resolve. I think that without the presence of unions, I think a lot of individuals become prey to demagoguery. I think that's more so in the United States, you'll see, and in France and the UK, where unions have been weakened dramatically. And I think that can also hold in the case of international issues. So this is where I think we see part of the rise of nationalism, because you have large numbers of people who are aren't getting, as it were, some sort of rational source of information at their everyday lives. Now, just to conclude this. One, of course, it's not clear that unions can be brought back, at least in those societies where they are in retreat, like in the United States or in France. I don't know to what extent the prospects for that coming back is. And so then the question is, what is it that can replace them to serve this same kind of role of information, or free information dissemination and shortcuts? I don't know. In the United States right now, churches are the thing, but these are evangelical churches. I'm not convinced they do a very good job disseminating rational information. Two, there's another puzzle about this, because if you think you need, and this is, you need to create institutions like unions or something like that to make it easier for people, to give them more access to free information, okay? That means you have to step into the political system. You have to intervene in it in a way that says, okay, these are the interests we think are being neglected, and so we're going to try to enhance the information with regard to those things. And of course, the standard story in democratic theory is you let the people decide. Okay, that's how it's supposed to work. And yet here what you're doing is you're intervening in some sense to do that. Now, I don't think that's an insuperable worry, ultimately, because you might say, well, it's better than nothing. But it is still a worry. It's a puzzle about how democracy is supposed to work. Okay, so in conclusion, I want to say there is this basic puzzle. I think we have some of the tools to analyze how to resolve this puzzle. I cannot say that I have solved it entirely myself, but I think we have tools that help us go beyond what the skeptics have been saying and help us understand the possibility that democracy can work, and maybe can help us understand how democracy can be made better if we look at this economics of information and the institutional background of those societies. Okay? Thank you very much.